going well. We have already completed our first lesson. Today, we're gonna talk about a new topic. Here is a video. This video gonna help you to understand what is the topic about. Are you ready to watch the video? We'll come back after watching it.
Thank you.
functional KU. What's the video about? Yes, child labor. Child labor means, I know you have the answer. Yes, children under 14 years engage in different works. Okay, didn't you enjoy your childhood? Yes, not only you, we all people enjoyed our childhood because it's the most beautiful period in one's life. No tension, no worries. Am I right? Yes. I have a question to you. Do you all count your blessings or always worry over something which you do not have? Think. After watching this video, do you really think that you all are blessed? Yes, we all are blessed. We have the proper opportunity to get education, wear good dress, colorful shoes which match to our dress, sufficient food to eat, proper shelter to live in, vehicles. These all blessings we have in our life. Have you ever thought of some people who do not have all these blessings in their life? Yes, there are some people, they do not have all these blessings in their life. Is that their problem? No, of course not. So, here, through this lesson, we are going to learn the plight of street children forced into labor in the early ages and deny the opportunity of schooling. So, here starts our lesson, lesson number 2, Lost Spring, Stories of Stolen Childhood. Lost Spring, what does it mean? Spring is the name of a season, you people know. What's the specialty of spring season? Yes, beautiful flowers bloom. So, we have discussed childhood as the spring season in one's life because that was the most beautiful period in one's life. So, we compare childhood as spring season. So, here in our story, there are some people, they lost their spring season, that is their childhood, due to some reasons. So, who lost the spring season in their life? That we are going to learn. What happened to them? What is the story about? So, the title of the story is Lost Spring. Somebody lost the spring in their life. Okay, are you ready? If you are ready, let's get started. Anis Jain is the author of this lesson. She is born in Hyderabad in the year 1964. She received her education in Hyderabad and in the United States of America. Her parents were both writers. Anis Jain began her career as a writer in India. She has been an editor and columnist for major newspapers in India and abroad. This story has taken from her book Lost Spring, Stories of Stolen Childhood. It focuses on the children from deprived background. Anis Jain is noted for her lively and vivid descriptions. Here, in this story, she analyzes the grinding poverty and traditions which condemn these children to the life of exploitation. In this lesson, we have two stories. The first story is, sometimes I find a ruby in the garbage, and the second story is, I want to drive a car. But through this class, we are only going to discuss the first story, that is, sometimes I find a ruby in the garbage. Are you ready? Here starts our lesson. Why do you do this? I asked Sahib, whom I encounter every morning, scorching for coal in the garbage dumps of my neighborhood. Sahib left his home long ago, said amidst the green fields of Dhaka, his home is not even a distant memory. The more many storms that swept away their fields and homes, his mother tells him. That's why they left, looking for gold in the big city where he now lives. I have nothing else to do, he mutters, looking away. Go to school, I say glibly, realizing immediately how hollow the advice must sound. There is no schools in my neighborhood. When we build one, I'll go. If I start a school, will you come? I ask, half joking. Yes, he says, smiling broadly. A few days later, I see him running up to me. Is your school ready? It takes longer to build a school, I say, embarrassed at having made a promise that was not meant. But promises like mine abound in every corner of his bleak world. Here starts our first story, Sometimes I Find a Ruby in the Garbage. Anil Jain, our writer, every day she comes across a boy named Saheb. The boy used to come to her neighborhood for searching something in the garbage. So every day our writer used to observe this boy. And actually, Saheb belongs to Bangladesh, Dhaka. There were many storms. Due to the storms, all their fields and homes had swept away. So people from Bangladesh, they migrated to India. You all know that any natural calamities occur, people used to migrate from one place to another. So here, our Saheb belongs to this category. Due to this storm, what happened? They just lost all their fields and homes. So Saheb's family, along with other people, they just migrated from Dhaka to India. Actually, this happened when he was too small, and he doesn't know anything about this. His mother only told him these stories. So home is not even a distant memory. Anyhow, every day he used to come to Anis Jung's neighborhood for searching something in the garbage. So one day Anis Jung asked him, why do you do this? Because we know that garbage is not a hygienic place, okay? So this boy, every day along with the other boys, he used to come and search something in the garbage. That's why the author asked him that, why do you do this? Immediately, Saheb replied that, I don't have anything else to do. I have nothing else to do. Like that way, he just replied. So Anis Jung said that, you are a boy, go to school. Anis Jung said. But after giving that advice to go to school, then only Anis Jung realizes that such an advice to go to school to these type of people is really an empty advice. So Saheb replied that, we don't have any schools in our neighborhood. If they built one, definitely I would go. Like that, the boy said. From these words of this boy, we come to know that the boy is very much interested in going to the school or getting educated. So Anis Jung asked that, if I built one, would you come to my school? Like that, she asked. So the boy gave a broad smile and replied that, of course, if you build one, I would come to your school. And that meeting was over and days just ran. After some days, this boy again, they both met each other. This boy came to her and asked that, is your school ready? So Anis Jung replied that, boy, it's not that much easy to build a school. Okay, it takes time. Like that, she just replied. But after that only, she realized that giving promises to these type of children should be very careful. Why, you know? Because they don't have any blessings in their life. So if somebody gives some promises to them eagerly, they would wait for getting it. So here, she just simply made a promise to that boy, okay? At the same time, that word, okay, building a school, that word was really a great happiness for that boy, okay? So he was just eagerly waiting for that school. So here, Anis Jung realized that if we are not able to keep the promise, should not gave the promises to these type of children like that way she just realized. After months of knowing him, I ask him his name. Sahib-e-Alam, he announces. He does not know what it means. If he knew as meaning Lord of the Universe, he would have a hard time believing it. Unaware of what his name represents, he roams the streets with his friends, an army of barefoot boys who appear like a morning birds and disappear at noon. Over the months, I have come to recognize each of them. Why are you wearing chappals? I asked one. My mother did not bring them down from the shelf, he answers simply. Even if she did, he will throw them off, adds another who has wearing shoes that do not match. When I comment on it, he shuffles his feet and sees nothing. I want shoes, says a third boy who has never owned a pair all his life. Traveling across the country, I have seen children walking barefoot in cities on village roads. It is not lack of money, but a tradition to stay barefoot, is one explanation. I wonder if this is only an excuse to explain away a perpetual state of poverty. After months of knowing him, one day Anisjan asked his name. So he replied that, Sahib-e-Alam. Anisjan was shocked to hear the name because the meaning of the name is Lord of the Universe. And she started thinking that this boy, he doesn't know the meaning of his name. If he knew it, what is the meaning of the name? What is it? Lord of the Universe. But he doesn't own anything and roam over the streets, okay, with an army of barefoot boys for picking the rag. Okay, that means he is a rag picker. Okay. So, he doesn't know the meaning of his name. Actually, he is the Lord of the Universe but doesn't own anything. So, Anisjan observed all these boys. They just come to her neighborhood early in the morning like morning birds and they disappear at noon. And whenever this group of army of boys come to her neighborhood, she used to observe majority of the boys don't wear shoes or chappal. So one day she asked their boy, why don't you wear chappal? So a small boy replied that, I have shoes but my mother kept it on the shelf and she never takes it out. So another boy said that if his mother gives those chappals to him also, who would wear which do not match to us? Like that way he just asked. And the third boy says, I want chappals. That boy, he doesn't own a chappal in his life at all. So you just imagine, for us, shoes or chappal means an easy thing to buy. Am I right? If you want, you go to shop and buy. That too, matching shoes and all. And your parents are ready to buy for this. But you just imagine here, these boys, even they do not have a single pair. So, Anisjan started thinking that she had another experience while she was just traveling through somewhere. That time she saw that some village boys, they were just going barefoot. Barefoot means without shoes. And she asked those boys why they just go barefoot. That time they just replied that it's due to tradition. Some traditions are there, they don't wear chappals. Okay. So that was the reply. But here, actually, it was not this tradition. These boys, they do not have money to buy it. Means the shoes or chappals, which is not affordable for them. She just realized the fact. I remember a story a man from Udupi once told me. As a young boy, he would go to school past an old temple where his father was a priest. He would stop briefly at the temple and pray for a pair of shoes. 30 years later, I visited this town and the temple, which was now drawn in an air of dissolution. In the backyard were lived in a new place. There were red and white plastic chairs. A young boy dressed in a grey uniform wearing socks and shoes, a rag, panting and on a folding bed. Looking at the boy, I remembered the prayer another boy had made to the goddess when he had finally got a pair of shoes. Let me never lose them, the goddess had granted his prayer. Young boys like the son of the priest now wore shoes, but many others like the rag pickers in my neighborhood remained shoeless. Now, Alice Jung remembered a story a man from Udupi told her once. When that man was young, okay, small boy, that time his father, he used to go to school when our chapel, okay, and his father was a priest. And those days, you people know that those who work in a temple or church, they used to get a very less salary. So that boy's father was a priest and he was not able to afford shoes for his son. And then this boy used to go to school without shoes. So every day he used to cross the temple to reach school. So whenever he reached the temple, he just paused sometime there and used to pray to the God, "Please God, you just grant me shoes," like that way he used to pray. So now Alice Jung says that boy's prayer God heard. Okay, now the living conditions and everything, it's changed for the priest. Okay, now the priest, they just own good house, and even their children, they just have uniform, socks, shoes, everything. Okay, their lifestyle extremely changed. Okay, so God had just heard their prayer, that's why now those type of people, they used to get everything in their life. Okay, but here still nobody, even the God also did not listen to the prayer of these rag pickers, and still they remain in poverty. They do not have the chapel or any blessings in their life. They just remain barefoot. My acquaintance with the barefoot rag pickers leads me to Simhapuri, a place on the periphery of Delhi, 8 miles away from it. Metaphorically, those who live here are sweaters who came from Bangladesh back in 1971. Sahab's family is among them. Simhapuri was then a wilderness. It still is, but it is no longer empty in structures of mud with roofs of tin and tarpaulin, devoid of sewage, drainage or running water, live 10,000 rag pickers. They have lived here for more than 50 years without an identity, without permits, but with ration cards that get their names on voters list and enable them to buy grain. Food is more important for survival than an identity. If at the end of the day we can feed our families and good bed without an aching stomach, we would rather live here than in the fields that gives us no grain. Say a group of women in tattered sarees when I ask them why they left their beautiful land of green fields and rivers. Wherever they find food, they pitch their tents that become tent's home. Children grow up in them, becoming partners in survival. And survival in Simhapuri means rag picking. Through the years, it has acquired the proportions of a fine art. Garbage to them is gold, it is their daily bread, a roof over their heads, even if it is a leaking roof, but for a child, it is even more. Anis Jung got the opportunity to mingle with these rag pickers, means that the army of barefoot boys along with Sahib. So that acquaintance with these boys leads her to Simhapuri. Means that Anis Jung decided to visit their place, okay, where they settled. So Anis Jung decided to visit that place, that is Simhapuri. Simhapuri is the outskirt in Delhi. So Anis Jung one day, she just went to that place. The place is Simhapuri. There just she could see, okay, 10,000 rag pickers. They put tent over there and settled their life in the outskirts of Delhi, that is Simhapuri. So Anis Jung just reached there. She just looked around, okay, that time she could see these things. Drainage was one side, running water, no hygiene at all, no bathrooms were there, okay. So all the dirty things she could see everywhere. And along with this dirtiness, people, 10,000, almost 10,000 people used to live in that unhygienic situation. So she just went there and she came to know that the people, the 10,000 rag pickers, those who were living there, they do not have any identity. No identity card, no Aadhaar card, nothing. They just on. Understood. At the same time, they have one thing. What is it? You know, ration card. How they got ration card? They belong to another country and they just got the Indian ration card. How? They just got it because you know that the politicians used to visit them and they just wanted to get these people's votes. For that purpose, they just made their list and gave the ration card. But these poor ragpickers, they don't know anything about this. Whenever the politicians come and ask them to cast their vote, they used to give. Why? Because these ragpickers used to think that they got a great blessing, that is the ration card. Why? Because with this ration card, they can buy grains for feeding their stomach. Okay? So food is everything. Okay? So they need that food for survival. That's why the ration card is a great thing for them. So Anis Jang just reached there. She saw many women there. She asked a woman that, why did you leave your place? You had a beautiful field and homes there and you just left everything there and you came to a new place. Why did you leave your place like that? She asked. So the woman said that the fields were very beautiful, but it never gives us food, okay, due to that storm and all. But now here we came, at least we can feed our stomach. We used to just pick the litters and the garbage and used to sell it and find our livelihood, okay. At least we can just satisfy our stomach, okay. So we just left all those things and came here. So now at least one time meal we used to get to satisfy our stomach and we have a safe roof. Means that they had small huts, okay, but they were very happy because above their head they had a roof. But we cannot call it as a house, okay, it was just leaking house only with tin, tarpaulin and everything. They just with that they made a small huts, okay. But then also they were very happy, they don't have any problem at all. They live a happy life there, like that Anis Jang realized. I sometimes find a rupee, even a 10 rupee note. Sahib says, his eyes lighting up. When you can find a silver coin in a heap of garbage, you don't stop scorching. For there is hope of finding more. It seems that for children, garbage has a meaning different from what it means to their parents. For the children, it is wrapped in wonder. For the elders, it is a means of survival. The children in the Simapuri used to help their parents for finding money for their livelihood. So here, Sahib says, sometimes we children used to go and search in the garbage and used to get 1 rupee coin or 10 rupees. So we don't stop there, we just search to find more money in the garbage. Means that we just imagine the pathetic situation of these children, which situation they are going through. Every time they used to search something in the garbage, so for these type of children, garbage means it's wrapped in something wonder wrapped in it, like that way they just feel. And even they don't know the seriousness, the situation which they are going through. At the same time, for the elders or their parents, garbage means their survival only. Through that only, they used to get money. Because of that, garbage is their survival. So, the two category used to take garbage in two different ways. One is the small kids, okay? For them, garbage is wrapped in wonders. And then, for the elders, garbage means it's for their survival. One winter morning, I see Sahab standing by the fenced gate of the neighborhood club, watching two young men dressed in white playing tennis. I like the game, he hums. Continue to watch it standing behind the fence. I go inside when no one is around, he admits. The gatekeeper lets me use the swing. Sahab too is wearing tennis shoes that look strange over his discolored shirt and shorts. Someone gave them to me, he says in the manner of an explanation. The fact that they are discarded shoes of some rich boy who perhaps refused to wear them because of a hole in one of them, does not bother him, for one who has walked barefoot, even shoes with a hole, is a dream come true. But the game he is watching so intently is out of his reach. One winter morning, Anis Jain saw that a sahab was standing by a fenced gate of a neighborhood club. Inside the club, two men, they were playing tennis. So sahab was just standing and watching the game. Anis Jain went near to him. So sahab said that, "I am very much interested in this game," like he said. And sahab told her that even if nobody is there inside, sometimes the gatekeeper allows me to go inside and I used to play in the swing. Like that he said. So Anis Jain just looked at him that time. Sahab just wore a colorless t-shirt and shorts, and not only that, he got a pair of shoes, okay? But Anis Jain observed that there was a hole in it. And she came to know that perhaps a rich boy, he might have thrown his shoes because of the hole in it. But for our sahab, he doesn't bother about the hole. Why? Because before he was barefoot and now this is the dream come true. Even if it is a hole in the shoe, he was able to get a shoe. So he was very happy to wear it. At the same time, the game he was watching from outside, which was really out of his reach. This morning, Sahib is on his way to the milk booth. In his hand is a steel canister. "I know, work in a tea stall down the road," he says, pointing in the distance. "I'm paid 800 rupees and all my needs." "Does he like the job?" I ask. His face, I see, has lost the carefree look. The steel canister seems heavier than the plastic bag he would carry so lightly over his shoulder. The bag was his. The canister belongs to the man who owns the tea shop. Sahib is no longer his own master. Another morning, Anis Jain met Sahib. That time he was just carrying a steel canister on his shoulder and he was on the way to the milk boat. So when he saw Anis Jain, he just came to her and said that, "I got a job in that tea stall and I'm paid 800 rupees. Means that he got the job in the tea stall and those people used to pay, give the salary 800 rupees. And not only that, three times meals also I get. Like that way he just said. And that time Anis Jain saw that he was just carrying the canister on the shoulder and which was really heavy, okay? And that carefree look also has gone from his face. Before he was just carefree, he used to enjoy his work and all. But now, he became serious, like that way she just felt. Anyhow, she just asked herself that, does he like a job? He just asked that question to herself. And she herself came to the conclusion that before he was carrying the plastic bag and that was his plastic bag only and he was the owner of that plastic bag. Now he was just carrying the steel canister which belongs to the tea shop owner. Means that Sahib is no longer his own master and his name is Lord of the Universe. Before at least he owns what that plastic bag, but now that also he just lost. Means that Sahib is no longer master of his son. Here is our story. So my dear children, this is a real life story. And here our writer Anis Jain wanted to put some thoughts to your mind. There are some people around us, they do not have any blessings in their life. Here we came to know about Sahib's life. Not only that, an army of children used to come to Anis Jain's neighborhood. They do not have any blessings in their life. Even they do not have proper shelter to live in, sufficient food to eat, proper dress to wear, and even they do not have the chappal or shoes to wear, okay, because of poverty. parents are not able to buy for them, lack of money they have, okay, they don't have sufficient money to buy or sufficient money to satisfy their children need. So here, Anish just ask you to think your blessings. You just count your blessings, okay, how blessed you people are. You used to get all the blessings in your life, but you don't know the value of it. At the same time, these people, when Anish Jung went to Simapuri, she just saw that with all these drawbacks, these people were very happy, okay. They don't have any blame, okay. They never blame anyone. And even, they were very happy to live there. At least, we had this house, we have this much food and everything. They were very happy with that. So, here the writer wanted to tell you that every time you just must count your blessings. Every time should not worry over the things which you do not have. Okay? If you just worry such things every time, you should think these types of people, okay, around you. Okay, my dear children, this is for today's class. I'll meet you soon with the second story. Thank you.